Hey, everyone. Welcome to the Horror PSA presented by Scary Nerd. And as always, we are your hosts. I'm Paul.
I'm Saul.
And I'm Angie.
The following is a public service announcement.
The centuries-old vampire Count Dracula comes to England to seduce his barrister Jonathan Harker's fiancée, Mina Murray, and inflict havoc in a foreign land. I feel it doesn't really encapsulate. I feel it doesn't really encapsulate the 1992 epic classic Bram Stoker's Dracula from Francis Ford Coppola.
See, I told you guys last week, Paul loves this movie.
This is one of the greatest movies ever. So
we're going to have a difference of opinion.
Saul, this might be strike three then.
No, this isn't going to be strike three.
Cinematically, we'll this film is gorgeous.
Yes, I agree with that.
Cinematically, I mean, you've got so many themes, so many beautiful renditions that I'll probably just jizz all over this whole episode. So sorry about that, guys, but I love the cinematography of this film. Cinematography,
I give you that. I agree with it. It's beautiful, but a lot of the story and a lot of the pacing to me, I was like, what the hell was that?
Okay, but that's based on the book, though. You can't blame FFC for that.
Yes, I can.
Well, no, he's the director. He should have known when to cut and when to
no, because there's none. So whatever you're talking about is not happening in this movie.
There are tons of books Paul that have had really, really good adaptations every single to the second. Movie. But I don't have, think this was.
But have you ever read the book?
No.
Because it's vastly different.
I have not read it either.
I have not read the book either.
Not vastly different. It is different, though. There's a lot more, obviously, because you know, every book has more than the fucking movie. Yeah. But
still, though, I feel like there have been other movie book adaptations and or the movies, whatever, that were better than this. Because to me, there was a lot of scenes that were like, that was just it.
Well, I guess then we would say that would be the guy who wrote the screenplay's fault.
If you've never read the book, then you don't know. Maybe those scenes were important and you just didn't get. What didn't you get?
They just ended.
Everything just tied in well. You need to watch the movie again.
I'm not wasting 2 hours of my life again.
Anyway, we should. I wanted to make
it's
a note.
It's Gary fucking Oldman. You're not it wasting 2 hours Oldman. Of your life, all right? But Gary fucking Oldman, Sir Anthony fucking Hopkins. No, you're not wasting your time.
I am wasting my time because when they're not in the scenes,
hey,
it just
everybody
makes it
shut
dumb.
Up. The guy who wrote the screenplay also wrote Hook.
Okay.
And Muppet Treasure Island.
Which were good. Better than this movie.
What? What?
They were better than this.
Tim Curry was a pirate in Muppet Treasure Island. Again, I mean, I'm not going to say that I don't love Tim Curry, but I mean, that's apples to oranges, Saul.
Okay. Just because you're bringing up Tim Curry. There is a great audiobook rendition of this where Tim Curry plays Van Helsing, where they're literally reading like the parts. Because the whole book is basically just journal entries and like letters and telegrams to, you know, back and forth between each other. And that's how the story is told for the most part. So basically you're hearing the whole story told, you know, while the actors are acting it out. And Tim Curry does a really great job as Van Helsing in the audiobook. So check it. I think it's on Audible.
I think that might be my biggest beef with it, now that you bring it up, is how everything was kind of like a little journal entry. That, I think, was what threw me off. Because you had the thing where they did the date, whatever need be, and then you'd have, let's say, Jonathan's little entry, because he would say his thing, and then they would just end. So to me, it kind of seemed like they chaptered the movie based on like the entries that way. And to me, it didn't.
They happen in chronological order. You have to have them that way.
But still, though, it just seems like, okay, you have this and then you start over completely with something different. To me, it just seemed like a whole bunch of little chapters that were just thrown in there. And then eventually everything ties together. But
I didn't think that, because I thought they were going back and forth between stories too much. Because there are times when they're just like in a scene fully with Dracula and Mina. And then they'll cut to what Jonathan's doing, or they'll cut to what other people are doing. So I felt that it wasn't just ending, but it was weaving the story together.
I didn't even feel the weaving. It just felt like, okay, you have this little part and then you start over with something else. and then you start over with something else, and you just keep going that until the movie ends.
Well, see, I was just Meanwhile, Jonathan's over here. I know how stories work, and I know how stories progress.
Like, and those are better than this.
And one's called the subplot, and it happens over here. And in the end, it ties. Give Kim the microphone.
All right. Anyway, let's get into the movie. So the opening of this movie is so
the best fucking opening to any movie.
It's so fucking beautiful. The map and then the fire and the sword. So badass.
That is how you grab somebody and be like, you're gonna watch this movie.
It's so thematic.
It is so.
It's so like beautiful with the giant cross and everything in the background and
the brooding low slow build bassy music. That just opens with Anthony Hopkins' voice narrating everything. Yes, there's nothing better than this.
And his armor, I always thought it looked like muscle. I always thought that was the coolest armor
I like ever. It because it looks like muscle, and I put it's the coolest fucking armor ever. It looks like something the devil would wear himself to battle.
Yes. I did like the armor.
The armor was cool. Yeah. And I love the opening war scenes, how you only see things in the shadows. Like nothing's in focus. Nothing. You can't see any of the details. It's all shadows until the battle's over. And then they focus in on.
Like cinematically, like just like imagery and the, just everything together. I'm like,
yeah, but they even have like those paper like puppets in the back. You know?
That's later. That's not the opening scene.
Yes, it is. It's when they're doing the fighting and the war and everything. Okay, but, yeah. All
right. Well, there's another part later they do that.
Well, yeah, they do it a lot. Francis Ford Coppola.
Just say FFC.
FFC, you're gonna
FFC all the time.
FFC. But yeah, the opening is so pretty. And like I said, everything. And I also love crazy Romanian Van Helsing. Romanian Anthony Hopkins.
And even Oldman's just like, even though he's speaking a different fucking language, and like there's some parts where they don't have the subtitles or whatever.
Yeah.
And even when he's delivering his lines in another fucking language, like you still just see the passion and like just his just raw like energy that he brings to it. And you like, even though you don't know what he's saying, like you still understand everything that's going on.
Yeah.
And it's just, just the greatest fucking cinematic opening ever.
Yeah, it's very beautiful.
Into just the simple yet powerful little title card with little flames around it. And that's all you need.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. When he pierces the cross with the sword, I've always loved how the blood starts flowing. And then by the end of that scene, like it's fucking spewing forth. And like everything's just covered in blood.
I have a question, though, about Winona's early character.
They saw that,
the first one where she jumps to her death into the ocean or wherever need be, right?
Yeah.
How the fuck did they recover her body?
They fished her out.
They fished her out. They went down there. They got a little rope.
If you drop your keys in the creek, what are you going to do? You're going to reach in and pick them up, man.
Yeah, but you're in an ocean and there's currents.
There's no ocean.
Where the hell it was, though?
It was a river. They said she threw herself into the river.
Okay, and back in, what was this, fucking 1400, what did they say, 1462?
Something like that.
They knew how to navigate riverways. This was the lifeblood for anyone back then. It's all they had. There was no trains, so like, yeah, they knew how to get shit out of the rivers and how to work rivers, man.
I love the title card that comes up. It's very SpongeBob. It's like 4 centuries later. That's what it made me think of. I was like, yep, that's what's happening right now.
And the fact that we opened the actual movie, like you get the opening like epilogue thing, whatever the fuck you call it, and you open the motherfucking movie with Tom fucking Waits. How amazing is Tom Waits in everything that he's ever fucking been in? He is a master, and I'm so glad that he got to be Renfield.
Renfield was great. I love crazy ass Renfield. He's just in the asylum eating insects and shit, man.
The master.
You can't master. I love that line when he just, the way he delivers it to
My favorite thing is his floofy hair. He had the best floofy hair in the whole film.
The scene where it's at the end and he kind of is like, you promised me eternal life and you gave it to that bitch.
Yeah,
he's
like, man.
The scene where he's like, I'm fighting for my soul, Dr. Seward.
Mm-hmm.
I love that part.
He reminded me a lot of Jim Carrey in Batman when he was in the insane asylum because he had the weird flappy arms.
Oh, yes, and the coat. Yeah.
The coat.
But then, okay, what's the point of those things if you could just take your hands out?
I don't know.
Because later on, he just has his hands.
Yeah, he does.
Unless it's like they're tied in there and they let him out later kind of thing.
Maybe they just untied it and pushed him in.
I'm assuming like that's just annoying then.
Yeah.
To just have, because even if you weren't crazy, like that just seems like it would make you crazy to have like those long sleeves, and like yes. you can't grab.
That's
anything.
Why they stopped asylums, like, because they realized it was just like, making the crazy people worse.
I go crazy just thinking about having to wear that thing. Like, just yes. imagine, like,
and like the asylum attendants were just in there with the cage around their head, guys, and they were yeah. just like walking around. I was like, this is clearly crazy. Why would you put crazy people in this craziness, like, to make them go crazy?
And what's the point of having a cage around somebody's head? Like, he's arms and his legs are still free. He's not going to be able to bite you, but he's still probably going to be able to choke you to death.
Well, no, the cage guys were the attendants. They were like, they? Yeah, they were okay. the,
yeah. You wear those when you work there for protecting
To protect
yourself.
Your head and face.
I don't get that.
Well, when you have vampires in the asylum.
And that's yeah. Well, we go from Renfield to seeing Jonathan's character, and he's got a new assignment to head over to Transylvania because Renfield is clearly crazy. He yes. came back from Transylvania clearly crazy. And I love how Jonathan's like, hey, what happened to Renfield in Transylvania? And his boss clearly was like, oh, nothing. It was just some personal problems.
Yeah, he has that like just that like half second where he's like, nothing at
like,
all.
He literally goes, just some personal problems. Like, just, what?
Just go there and come back. Go there, come back, and you'll be fine.
Like, he came back completely crazy, and now we got to send somebody else? That doesn't seem safe.
Yeah, and I love how even in 1462, where it's like, we're going to dangle this promotion in front of you to get yeah. you to do shit that we don't want to do.
There's no forward movement without putting yourself in bodily harm's way.
Go there and come back, and your position with our firm is assured, is what he says. I think some shit like that. I'm like, yeah, nothing's changed.
This is a great opportunity,
good opportunity
for you.
For an old man like yourself. You're nearly 20. Jesus, man.
Here's where we start with the cool transitions that FFC really went into and did well, with the peacock feathers over the kiss of Mina and Jonathan saying their goodbyes.
Yeah.
And that goes into the train travel with the sun and stuff.
Okay, when they're in that scene in the garden when they're kissing, whatever, and I'm like, who the fuck... Okay, this is how old I feel, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, who the fuck is this 20-something-year-old lady in this movie who's now playing a neurotic 40s middle-aged mom mm-hmm. in the 80s on yep. TV? And I'm like, what happened? Because whenever I see this movie, I'm immediately 11 years old again. And one part in particular, but we'll get to that later.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure you know which part that is.
I do, yes. But anyway, he starts off on his journey, and he's in this carriage with these other people, and they stop, and they're like, you're getting out here. And they just start shoving out shit. And one lady gives him a cross. And if somebody was like, you need this, bitch, I'd be like, I need to get out of here.
Not just that, though. My red flags will be like, why are they kicking me out? Why are they not taking me all the way there? And again, like you said, why are they giving me a cross? Yeah. Like, something's up.
And then the carriage of death comes.
You're,
that's what I call that.
You're going to need this. Take
yes.
this.
The carriage of death is so badass. Like, the guy just picks him up, basically, and throws him into the carriage. He's like,
yeah, that's
get
what
in here.
I thought, too. He's like, he reaches his arm out and just, like, picks him up and then just kind of pulls him in.
I'm like, I hope he got the other bags, because he had more bags.
Again, red flags would be like, mm-hmm. why is this dude picking me up, putting me into the carriage?
There's a lot of shit that Jonathan should be like, okay.
Yeah, Jonathan wasn't very bright. He was definitely trying to grab that carrot the whole time.
That's what
he
I'm
was
telling
like,
you.
I need
like,
this promotion.
You have to dangle that, and that's where he's like, all right, well, you know, I'm just going to go along with this shit, even though it seems weird to me, but.
I love when he looks out the window, and he's trying to talk to the driver or whatever, and then he sees the cliff down yeah. below, and then just shuts the window.
Like, driver, are we on? Oh, shit.
Oh, fuck.
I wrote down, like, I'm just going to lean over to the other side, just in case. Just going to shift the weight over, you know.
And doesn't he also see the wolf kind of spying on him, too?
Yeah, he sees the wolves. He sees that this guy just picked him up and threw him in the carriage. So he's seeing all these big red flags, like we said, right? And we're like, no, Jonathan. But the biggest one that always gets me is the doors on the castle just opening by themselves.
Yeah.
Oh, like, that and not the blue fucking flames that they drive through? Because I'm okay. I don't care anymore. Like, okay, I get the whole thing.
Did he see the blue flames?
Yes. When they go into the fucking castle for the first time, like, he's looking out and you see the blue flames coming up as he's passing through in the fucking carriage thing.
Oh,
like,
I didn't realize he saw those.
So, yeah. Okay. No. Like, that's the thing to me. I'm like, all right, the wolves are one thing. I get this is a weird country. You know, people, especially back then, like, you didn't know a bunch of shit about anything, right?
Yeah.
It was all maps and people just drew themselves and shit.
There was no
so I get you're like, it's weird terrain and blah, blah, blah. Like, but the blue flames for me, I'm like, all right, there's something not natural.
Yeah, that's not for me. But when the doors open, yeah. I'm like, if a guy from London, right, who has seen what they have, technological yeah. advances for what they have yeah. of the day, right?
Which are clearly more advanced than they would be in Romania yeah. at this
but
time.
But he sees a door open by itself, and he's not suspect about that at all. Like how does
that open? And the fact that he never sees any servants.
No, either. He sees no one.
So
he doesn't even really see the carriage driver, like, because no, you don't ever see his face.
That's Dracula.
Yeah.
It is him. He... In the book, he definitely has suspicions, and then he kind of later is, you know, he's not, I don't think he's as dumb in the book as he is in that. He movie. Pieces more things together in the book.
Oh, when he, okay. later on in the film, after he comes back and everything, and even before that, I'm like, did they cut his hair again at some point? Because he's looking really Ted-ish right yeah, he now. Wears, like,
he that's wears all like, I can picture.
Yeah. He has like three or four different wigs, and there's one part I'm like, why is that wig different but the same color? Like,
yes.
It clear. I'm like, what? Like, okay, here's the one I thing. Think they lost a wig and then they okay. found it and they put it back in, because there's definitely something going on with his hair yes. throughout this movie.
I do have a question, and this is jumping way ahead. And we'll get to it probably when we get to there, but I do have to bring it up. Is how the fuck did his hair turn white?
He was so scared, and they kept depleting him of blood. Yeah,
I just took it more as like...
they never explained why it went white.
Well, because it's, I always took it as because, you know, they're draining him and just barely keeping him alive. Uh-huh. So it's like, I don't know, almost like he's been so near death. Like,
and the shades of it kept changing. Like,
well, I think that was the whole wig thing. Like, okay. He kept... they lost... Somebody in the props department lost the fucking wig for a bit.
Sometimes hair just goes white. It happened to our president recently. I mean, I don't know.
Mm. Poor Ted.
But yeah, they definitely had some weird wigs, and I just after there's one time when, well, we'll get to the part and I'll just leave it till then, but the door's opening by themselves. I was like, yeah, right. But then we get our first look at our Drac, and he's got the hair, the cape, and I was like, yes, I'm so fucking here for this look. Like, he's just fucking fabulous, man. The he's thing, got that long ass cape. That's just, you know, some dramatics right there.
The
most
about this movie is when you do get introduced to him and you see the creepy thing with the shadow.
Oh, I love the shadow. I
absolutely loved the shadow.
Yes, it's so creepy. It adds a whole other layer of just kind of nonsense, because you don't really need it. There's no use for it. He doesn't do anything, but it's so cool. My wish is
they would have done more with it, because they really only ever do anything with the shadow when he's at the castle. Mm. I would have loved to have seen that being incorporated later into the movie.
Yeah.
Because it was such a cool aspect. To me, it kind of gave its own character with the shadow.
And another thing they do in this film that we had previously mentioned that a lot of people don't do is they do the bat flight thing.
Yeah.
They do the whole flight cam. And I always love those scenes. He's quick, though. Because it's not even so much as a flight, as it's just a fast forward kind of a rush. It's
kind of, I think I called it the, well, I think later I called it like the werewolf, like Evil Dead cam or something. Kind of when he turns into that wolf thing. Yeah. When he turns into the wolf guy later, when they get to England, that always reminds me of the wolf from Monster Squad.
Yeah.
Every time I've ever seen it. Because then I think of that one dude, then I'm like, it's always a werewolf. I do want to point out, when they go in, the line that he says is almost verbatim from the book. They've kind of put a little twinge on it. But enter freely of your own will and leave something of the happiness you bring. That's definitely directly from the book, but like I said, they changed it a little bit. But I love it, the dinner scene when he's like, oh, I see the resemblance, and he has that little chuckle, and then Drac kind of just flips out at him, and he's just going into that whole monologue, and he's like, hey, motherfucker, don't laugh at me. I mean, my family history.
Yeah.
Because he's like, that, you know, that guy had some issues. But
there's an old man swinging a fucking sword around. Okay, Grandpa, calm down. I wasn't talking about you. Okay, Boomer, just chill. All right.
Jonathan gave him okay, Boomer.
Yeah. I get it. I'm sorry. All right. But yeah, because it's so funny. He's all gray and stuff. Yeah. I love when he's all gray and he's all old. There's some parts where they try to like have it where he's got that face, but still the young man hair. And he looks like the Cowardly Lion to me every time. And I can't take it seriously.
Yeah. He's definitely got so many different like looks in this movie. Like so much. I can't even imagine like the makeup and the hair and like just how every individual look, like how long it took just to get those.
The art department must have been massive for this film. Makeup and art, whatever.
Major patience too with all the makeup that he had to get applied to him too.
Well, he wanted to be in this fucking movie. Like, he was all about it when he read the script. I read that he actually took, well, I don't know if it was singing lessons, but he hired like a singing coach because he wanted to lower his voice a whole octave to give the Dracula character a more like sinister sounding tone when he spoke. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That is how fucking dedicated he was to this fucking movie.
I had noticed the lower octave, but I just assumed that was because he was doing the accent. But that's that's interesting.
Well, he wanted to get it right.
He was Dracula. He probably practiced and did what he heard. So. He did a lot for this. I love when he sees the hairy palms and I'm just like, gross.
I saw him like, oh, Drac is lonely. Yes. Like, the hairy palm things is real. That's where it originally comes from. It's Dracula.
It's Dracula.
The original one. The black spot, the hairy palms. Yep. It's all Dracula. Mm-hmm. He's like, I've been alone forever until, you know, Jonathan came over and I saw his bitch.
And then he's like, hey, I'll take no refusal. You're staying with me for 30 days. And Jonathan's just like, okay, that's like, not suspect at all.
Shit. Well, how do you get out of that in his point? Like,
I don't know. When he writes the letters, I'm like, no, help me.
When he writes, yeah. I'm like, oh, no, I thought of this whole thing. I'm like, all right. I'm like, if there was ever a situation where, like, I was in that, I'm like, I'm going to put, like, a secret code. I'm like, all right, I've written a bunch of letters that I've left at home. And if I put, like, F1, like, that's the letter you opened to be like, that's, you know, I'm in trouble. Like,
like, have it under a different nickname. And yes, just put yours truly, yes, different nickname. No, and like, that's your help, like, me sign, like, please.
Like, check on Betsy for me, and then you just open the Betsy envelope, and they're like, "Help me, I'm in trouble. Something's not right here."
Help.
Coded messages in your letters.
Yes, because as soon as he gave them the letters, and Dracula's like looking through, I'm like, and now he's looking at the end, like, now I know where Mina lives. Thank you, stupid ass.
And as the boss, right, who just sent Jonathan to go get these papers, he's like, just go real quick, come back. You'll be back, however quickly. It's not a big deal. But then now you've lost two fucking guys to Dracula. Don't you feel bad for that? Like, you were the one who was like, he just had personal problems, but now there's Jonathan.
Well, what do they even fucking do? Are they like a bank or a real estate company?
I have no idea.
Because basically he was buying up a bunch of real estate in England, and these guys were handling the deal. So I'm like, they're either like a bank or like a, you know, like a mortgage broker or whatever that shit. So I'm like, what do they even have to do? They have to go and, like, he's probably just a fucking notary. He's not even like a guy, you know?
Yeah,
like,
he just he's the part of the notary association. He's like,
I'm a notary republic, international notary republic.
I have to go get this notarized for this guy in Romania. Is that how shit used to have to work?
That's probably what it is, because he basically is like, we're all set. You just sign these and I'll sign these. And like,
now you take these papers, make sure the fucker signs them. Like, no. And then come back. That's awful.
And plus, like, you know, if this guy was, you know, obviously he's rich or whatever, and he's buying, let's say, like 10 properties or whatever.
Yeah.
So he's buying a bunch of places. So this firm's going to do whatever the fuck this guy wants. He'll be like, oh, he wants you to stay for a month? Then yes, you're going to fucking stay for a month. That's fine.
Not after your other one came back completely insane. You're not like, stay there for longer unexpectedly.
But you don't know, like, what they thought happened to him.
So you're saying people in England in the 1600s were dumb?
Yes.
First of all,
yes,
this was the 1800s.
1800, sorry.
1897. Still. Second of all, because he could have come back and just been normal, and then all of a sudden Drac got to him or whatever and started talking to him, making him go crazy and shit, and they just thought he was crazy. Like, they would have been...
No, they said it came back because he didn't complete the assignment, and that's why Jonathan had to go.
Yeah.
So, no, he was crazy.
Okay, but whatever happened, I'm saying that the real reason, obviously, they're not going to know that he's under the trance of a fucking vampire.
I'm not saying they would get that, but I would say that they would have to feel somewhat responsible for sending two of your notaries that have gone crazy or missing.
They didn't really care about Renfield because they're like, all right, well, who's next in line?
Lifespan was shorter back then anyway. Maybe they're just like, fuck it, we lost another one, guys.
Well, maybe Renfield was a little off to begin with, and they're like, well, it was due. He was just fucking nuts. We thought he could handle it, but he just went batshit crazy, and you know, whatever. Just send Jonathan. He's good. He's hungry. He's poor. He needs the money.
That was the final straw for him.
Dangle that promotion and he'll go.
Yeah, no, I was like, I'd be writing in there, help me, this old man wants to kidnap me. this old white dude says I have to stay with him for 30 days. Please help me.
I love when we're back at the Lucy's the Hamford Estate or whatever the fuck they call it.
Some big fancy home.
They have a name for whatever. And Lucy's in the book looking up porn and then typing a letter. And I love Mina is. Sorry. Yeah. Mina's typing a letter and looking up porn. And then Lucy comes in and I love how she's like, ah, Jonathan's making you learn the typewriter. Like, you poor people.
I literally wrote down, hey, girl, stop typing and go fuck somebody already. Lucy is horny.
Lucy, yes. Well, she's almost 20 and she hasn't been married yet.
Well, yeah. And I guess that means you wouldn't have had sex.
She wouldn't have had sex at almost 20 years old. So, yeah, she's ready to burst.
She is.
This whole movie is about just horniness, basically.
Yes, pretty much.
This whole movie is spanning four centuries of Dracula's horniness and hairy palms, is basically, and Mina's boobs.
Yes.
We'll get the, 'cause especially towards the end of the movie, like, it is all about Mina's boobs, the end of the movie.
Maybe for you, Paul.
Wait till we get to those parts. I'll tell you exactly.
But I love Lucy. She's so horny, and she's got her three gentlemen callers that she just keeps inviting over to her house. I'm like, why are these three dudes all vying for this woman's vagina? This is a very weird kind of ceremonial thing that they did back in the day.
They're courting.
Yeah, well, you had to court back then, and on top of that, obviously they're rich if they're just like, yeah, look at this huge fucking house that we have people just come over at all hours of the night. And
but still, would that be anything that you guys would do? Like, I'm gonna go fight these other three dudes, like, for a chick.
Well, yeah, but it's okay. But you're thinking in today's terms. Yeah. And back then, if it was like, if
they had no Tinder,
you wanted to do, you know, if you wanted to court this girl or whatever, like, you have to go through those fucking steps or whatever. Yeah. Like,
I'm not saying that, anything bad against the guys. I'm saying, could you imagine a situation?
But you're saying that three vying for one?
Yes, if you were just, okay, I'm going to go. There's two other guys here. We're just going to sit and wait until she picks one of us?
Well, okay, and then to me, that's why she picked Lord Artie Homewood, because it was like Lord and Lady Homewood. So yes, it was more like regal. And it's like, yeah, because especially back then, I think, you know, marriages were strategic and fucking...
They were,
like,
and they were all,
and,
yes,
like, all that shit. So yes, it was kind of like, yeah, you had to throw your fucking hat in there, I guess.
It's just such a weird ceremonial kind of thing that they used to do back in the day. Like, three men go after this one chick.
It's like birds, like fucking like the peacocks or all that
yes,
shit.
Yes, they have to come dance around to show their pretty feathers.
They fluff the feathers up, and it's the same shit where you're like,
it is.
Look, I'm a big cowboy. Woohoo!
Yeah, one of them had a giant ass knife.
Humans are just adorable, aren't we? Like, our little ceremonies just for stuff. So we meet her three gentlemen callers. One's like this American
cowboy
guy.
Quincy P.
Quincy.
Oh, Miss Lucy, you look like the spring rain or something cheesy like that.
Yeah, something like that. But and Lucy's like, it's so big, can I touch it?
You're just fresh as a spring rain.
Lucy just talks in sexual innuendos. Maybe that's all her lines are.
Well, okay, after they're looking at the Arabian Nights porn book, and they're talking, she's like, I'm nearly 20. Like, I'm almost an old maid or whatever. So I'm like, yeah, that's probably, you know, 20 years of pent-up sexual frustration that she's got there. And especially when you got to wear that butt cage thing and all that. Like,
the big butt thing, yeah, the big extra padding dress thing.
Well, later when they have their weird lesbian scene, when she gets up, you see the butt cage.
They're just experimenting, Paul.
I'm engaged now. Let's have a quick lesbian scene in the rain. I'm like, yeah.
I mean, I guess.
Again,
like, there you go.
Well, yes. This movie was Paul's awakening.
That's not even the scene I'm talking about. It's not even...
I have two suspicions on which scene Paul is talking about.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think you know what scene it is.
I have a feeling.
We'll get there.
But the doctor we see is also... The doctor who's out to get a piece of Lucy's vagina is also the head doctor at the asylum.
Who's a morphine addict.
Yes, he is a morphine addict.
Was just for added fun, I think.
Hey, everybody was addicted to something back then. They were lithium addicts. They were the Chase and the Dragon addicts. Well, it's like back in the day. Well, think about
it. Like, yeah, everyone that was able to, like, you know, either solve crimes or was like a scientist or some sort of medical doctor, they were all on something.
Yeah, they were just on it.
Gotta think outside the box, baby.
Hey, in the 1800s, everybody had morphine. In the 1980s, everybody had a fucking Valium. It's the same. Yes. We're just all trying to get through the day. Some fucking chemical some way or the other.
If there's anything that's been consistent in human history.
Yes. We like our drugs.
Well, that's it. Well, like I'm saying, like their house, like you show up to the house and immediately there's a butler like, let me take your coat. Would you like a drink? And like, it's 4 in the morning, man.
And we get to see Renfield interact with the doctor, and the doctor thinks that Renfield is completely crazy. But I mean, in Renfield's defense, this doctor took a shot of morphine to the arm and then was like, let me go talk to this mental patient real quick.
Well, yeah, and that's when he has the hors d'oeuvres line, when he's got all the bugs and everything.
Yes, but okay, and then he asks for a cat.
No, okay. Yeah, I was like, wait, is Renfield gonna eat this cat? Like, what the fuck's going on
right now? I suspected that, but then when he said, I need lives for the master, I'm like, well, he could eat a cat.
Yeah. Well, no, see, I was thinking that, you know, at first he was saying, like, he wants to eat this, and then he was saying, but I want a pet, and then he was like, but he needs lives. I'm like, so what the fuck's going on? He's storing animals for him to eat, gonna
get that cat to the master.
Not knowing that he ate a whole fucking ship's worth of people and, you know, got back into his 30s or whatever on the way to England in his boxes.
Yeah.
Aboard the Demeter.
The Demeter. But anyway, this is where the story starts flipping back through Mina and Lucy to Jonathan's experience.
Wait, okay. I want to jump back real quick because he, for some reason, has some great lines. Tom Waits' character as Renfield, he has some great lines about, he's talking about life and everything. He's like, each life that I ingest in turn gives life to me.
Yeah.
Like, that's a weird way to look at it, but it makes a lot of fucking sense.
Yeah, and he says that the bugs are perfectly healthy. Yes, I'm like, well, like, they are.
Perfectly nutritious, doctor. And I'm like, well, technically he's right. So I'm like,
I don't know. Could you, like, sustain your whole nutrition from that, though?
I would think you'd have to eat like a shitload of bugs. Yeah. Like, you'd have to eat like handfuls, and like, it has to be like a huge amount.
Andrew, if movies have taught me anything, is that a lion and Lion King can sustain it off eating bugs. Oh,
that's true. There's got to be enough protein in there to sustain a lion. I mean, he was a cub into a full grown lion, too. So
if we go by movie logic, then
all right, fair enough.
Okay, but if we talk movie logic, that's bullshit, because I think there's some point at that lion would have been like, Pumbaa.
Right, that pig looks pretty delicious.
He would have hit puberty and been like, meat.
Yes.
He would have been like Madagascar, where he just wakes up with his mouth on his ass one day.
Did you just bite my ass, dude? That ain't cool.
But we get to see that Jonathan is making himself comfortable within Dracula's castle. He's shaving. He's got stuff going on. But then Dracula just starts floating around, and like, he still doesn't get all creeped out. There's nothing that deters
the shadow thing again. Was the thing where he should have been like, what the fuck?
Like, he comes in to shave him. And then,
not just that, though, but how he comes into the room, he's like, I didn't hear you.
Yeah. And after he touched his arm, like, no.
Okay. The mirror breaking part.
Yeah,
that would have been another. Okay, the blue flames and then the mirror breaking. Like, all right, that's up until that point, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, I do want to point out in this scene, Gary Oldman was drunk when he filmed this scene, and I don't know if it was FFC's idea or not, but they specifically filmed this scene after midnight to set the mood to just weird creepiness. And if you notice in the background, the walls are moving in, like they're physically moving in, because they wanted to make the claustrophobic feeling as he's shaving him and all that.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of like practical, like in camera, like effects they do with like the projections and like the moving walls and like just so much shit. Like, because FFC didn't want any like digital fucking, you know, effects or anything.
Yeah.
Like,
so he
wanted
everything
practical. And it was like, so he was like nuts about it, everything. So, after that point, when I thought it was funny because Jonathan gets that point, he's like, I've seen crazy shit already. And he's like, wolves and this and that. And I love how Dracula's like, oh, okay.
Okay.
And then goes for a climb on the
castle. You think that was some crazy shit because you saw some wolves? All right.
He's like, just
peek out that window in about, you know, 10 seconds. And he's like, he sees him crawling up the fucking wall and all that. I'm like, yeah, you need to fuck out of here, Jonathan.
That would have been like,
you need to get the fuck out of here and not go further into the castle to go have weird sex.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like, well, that's where you fucked up.
You skipped the part where after he shaves him and he nicks it.
Oh, yeah.
That
he was
does
gross.
That lick thing. And we're talking about Awakenings with Paul. I will have to, I was oddly turned on by that. Like, that's that's weird, but
it was,
I'm into it.
I think the way that
like, it's Oldman so sexual,
it,
but creepy.
It is, because it's like, it's just the way that he plays, like, it's such a, like, almost like a sweet release for him to be like, oh my god,
yes,
it tastes so fucking good. Like, freaking almost like if you were fucking like a crack addict, you know?
Yeah, oh, blood in a while.
Like,
yeah.
Slap ass.
Just a little. I was there for it.
And he kept doing it too, which made it even creepier.
Did.
Like maybe that's why he wanted to be drunk when he did this.
No, but like the first time he did it, right? He's shaving him, and he, all the while he's telling him, "Do not look in the castle. Do not go down this hall. Do not snoop around. There are shit in this castle you don't want
to
find.
If you were to go into the other rooms in the castle, make sure you fall asleep in this room.
Yes, like don't sleep anywhere but here. Like this is the one room you can sleep in."
Because you will get eaten if you don't.
But then when he goes out of the room and like he just starts going out for a nightly climb on the castle. I'm just like, why would that make you want to snoop around? No, Jonathan. I know, I'm like, the fuck there.
Well, okay. Did he say something like the front was locked and he couldn't get out, so he was trying to find another way out? I think he has a line in there something where he's like, I can't go out the way that I came in, so I need to find another way out of here. Mm-hmm. And this place is like a maze or something. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's in the book or if there's just a weird line in the movie that when he's doing one of his journal dialogue entries.
I kind of remember something vaguely about that when he tries to make his escape.
Oh, yeah. See, I'm just like, he told me not to snoop because there's worse things in this castle that I need to run. So I'm just going to stay here and like barricade myself into this room until hopefully morning and then climb out that window.
Yeah, and I'm not like, get out during the day.
Yeah.
Like, there's got to be some way where you can get out. Like if it's daytime.
Stop snooping in the dark, yes! You idiot. Like, wow. What are you doing?
But then again, he doesn't really know that the daytime is going to do anything for him.
He saw the fucker climb down the side of the castle. Yeah,
but I'm saying like, okay, we know vampires. We know things like, okay, they can't come out in daytime or their powers are
weakened.
I'm
not even saying that. I'm just saying for logic of back in the day, they thought bad things come out at night.
Okay.
That's what I'm saying.
So on that level, not the vampire thing.
No.
Okay, all right. Well, on that level, then sure.
Yeah. Like if you stay until you can see shit.
It's okay, especially if the lady gave you that cross.
Yeah.
He now looked at it and is like, don't put your faith into such trinkets or whatever.
Yeah.
And then the fucking mirror breaks. And I thought it was funny in that scene too, that he left, the vampire, Drac left and closed the door, but then the shadow was still there. I'm like, oh, the shadow got stuck in the room.
Yeah. He's like, shit.
He's like, damn it. I can't get out now. You see, I love that shadow. That shadow was awesome.
I wonder if that shadow is the reason why there's a shadow in Hook.
I got those vibes.
I just realized that.
I got those vibes from it.
Yeah, so dumbass Jonathan goes out and starts snooping.
And finds a treasure chest full of old perfume?
Like, starts going through it. I'm like, why are you snooping? You don't want to find anything in this castle.
This is the area where we see like the rats on the ceiling. All the liquids are...
dripping upward.
Dripping upwards and all stuff like that. FFC said that the laws of physics don't apply when you're in the presence of vampires. And that's why he wanted all the weird shit, especially like with the shadows and like the dripping up and like all that just random shit like that. Mm-hmm. And then in heading into this scene with the vampire brides, I think they're officially called whatever, how they appear to come up and all that.
Bitches be appearing out of thin air.
FFC worked with magicians to kind of make those scenes happen because he wanted them just kind of be more kind of mystical and whatever. So that's kind of why it's so kind of weird like that.
Mm-hmm. I have a question about that scene. He got his dick bit, right?
Yeah, probably. I don't know because it seems like that, but then you go to the mirror and his dick's not out and his clothes are still on. And I know they weren't. I know they wouldn't show all that or whatever. But I'm like, I don't know. Like,
he got his dick bit.
Yep.
Like, because he was like, ah. And she went down. Okay.
I love that he's looking at the perfume things or whatever. And then you hear this voice like, Jonathan.
Yeah.
I'm horny.
Where? He just goes along with it pretty willingly until they start biting him.
I wrote in, I'm like, why are you listening to them? You know, because it's like, lay down. Like all that stuff, and I'm like,
maybe it was the same thing like Drac kind of had, because he had that thing where he could just make people go with them.
Unless he was entranced or whatever.
Yeah.
And I guess that's what,
I mean, he could have just been entranced by his dick, because as soon as she touched him, he was just like, oh, God, somebody
again,
touched me.
Again, almost 20, he's not married yet. He's like, I got to finish this job.
I'm so horny.
Finish this job and go home and get married and have sex finally.
Finally.
No, it's like... It's like that Key and Peele. They're like, well, you have to abide by the local customs, of course. I'm on a business trip. This young vampire lady is wanting to have sex with me. I couldn't say no.
Hey, she put my dick in her mouth. What was I supposed to do?
Yes.
But it ends with the with Drac coming. I always love that he comes in and then it's almost like it's making fun of like sex scenes to me. Cause like, you know, like especially when you're kids and you see like those weird sex scenes, it was like, oh, there's an elbow or there's a back of the knee. It's always like those weird body parts.
Yeah.
And it was like, you had those, but then when you pull away and then when Drac comes in and you see him, like that vampire chick is two chicks into one. Like they're like joined together.
Yeah, when she walks
like,
back.
And she's like, it scuttles back and it's like, oh, there's two heads and oh.
Yeah. Okay, it makes sense now.
It's like, that's how you get those shots. Then there's two elbows and two like, oh, there, it's just one person. But
so did Jonathan technically participate in a five-way?
Maybe.
Or a four-way?
I don't know. I guess
you count the two bodies and one as one.
Yeah. I thought there was three.
And I mean, is there any vagina? Can you even count that?
I think it was two tops, one bottom, if I remember correctly.
Okay.
So that counts. I don't know. Does the four way to be determined by the number of vaginas or remember?
I don't know. What was the ratio to vaginas and mouths to dick? Okay.
I don't know. It's
I do love though how
math
Dracula,
was never my strong suit.
Chart. I love how when Dracula does come, he's like, "Hey, what the fuck are you doing?
He's mine, fuckers!"
Yeah,
like he gets so mad. How dare you?
How come they look young? Does he? Okay, this has always been my theory about Drac. Right,
mm-hmm.
He is so like he almost like he wants to die and doesn't care.
Yeah,
and like he just doesn't care, and that's why. I mean, because if we go the vampire lore, you know, the more he eats, the younger you can look and all that. So he just doesn't eat, doesn't care, just lets him look the way he looks, right?
Yeah.
He lets himself go because he's just so,
he's sad, he's depressed,
yes. Whatever. And that's why he's just old. And then, you know, when he sees the picture and all that, you know, it's always been like, all right, well, I need to get, you know, young again because she's back.
Yeah. I love when he comes in, though, and he gives the baby to the brides.
Yeah.
And Jonathan is like, oh my God. Oh, what's going on?
Okay.
Like,
so I want to point out about that. I want to point out, FFC was unhappy with Keanu Reeves, right? His performance. He was like, we need someone that's more of a heartthrob to appeal to women. And so he regrets making that decision. On the opposite side of that, Keanu Reeves is not happy with his performance either. But he was like, I had filmed a few movies back to back to back and I was super tired. He's like, I just couldn't give it my all in this movie.
Yeah, because shooting schedules are grueling.
And I would imagine shooting an FFC movie is fucking
much more demanding.
Yeah.
Like, because he like goes all out. I mean, we see in this thing, like it's fucking epic. So
yeah.
I'm sure, you know, having filmed, you know, how many movies and then coming into this one, like it's got to be daunting. So neither of the pair were happy with his performance in this movie, but nothing more than this scene when he has the, like, where he's just shaking his head.
Yeah. And
when he's just making those noises and then but it leads to that like iconic, like push into Drac with his like, just that laughter that just echoes into the next scene. I'm like, that is such an iconic shot in this movie. So
yeah.
I love that part, but it's just like, it almost just lessens it that it's like Keanu's got this.
He's like, real upset about it.
Like, damn it, Ted. Just calm down.
That's all I can keep hearing is most of this movie, too, is because I don't know how long removed it was from it, but I'm still hearing little
92
bits.
And what was... I don't know. Ted was what?
80s.
Was it 80s?
Six?
Was it that early?
It was 80 something and then 89, I think, for Bonus Journey.
Because that's all I could hear in parts of the movie. It was Ted.
There's a scene earlier where Mina is, she's in another room and it's raining in the background and she's typing and she's writing a letter to Jonathan or in her journal or whatever. And she looks at the picture of Jonathan and I'm like, why does he have that weird penis haircut? Like, it's just it's so awesome.
He does. Like, apparently those wigs are not good choices.
Like, was that his real hair and they just like parted it weird? Because I'm like, that's not weird. If you have that hair, don't part your hair in the middle. Like,
yeah.
You look like a dick. So after we get Jonathan's three or four or five way, we get to we cut to the scene where Mina's reading his letter, and I thought it was funny where it was like, "Your ever faithful Jonathan." I'm like, "Well, that shit didn't even last for the letter to get to fucking England for you before you had sex with the vampire bitches."
The thing that I thought was funny is when Mina took the letter to Lucy and she's like, "Something's wrong. I can tell in his letter." I'm like, "Bitch, it was a short little letter. How can you tell something's wrong right off that?"
Because
that's why. Yeah, because it was short. It was
a short letter.
Song. But still, I'm going back. I'm going back to what
because
Paul said,
he probably wrote nasty shit in there all the time. Like, fuck your ass.
I can't wait to put my penis in your vagina.
Dock my schooner in your port.
But still, though,
And then when he just writes, "I'm gonna stay here for a month.
Bye.
I'm in love with a big city living and a voodoo woman named Phyllis." But then she comes. Yeah, that's when Lucy comes out and it's like, "I've decided to marry Artie Homewood, Lord and Lady Homewood." Mm-hmm. And now it's raining. Let's kiss.
It's Dracula. I love how they see Dracula's eyes in the sky and then they just go about their business.
Yeah, again, I'm like, "Oh, okay, everything's calm and you're having this conversation. All of a sudden, like, fucking wind comes in and rain and just looks like this is not a good looking storm to just run out and do shit." But then you do see the eyes in the air and all that.
And they both kind of gasp. Yeah, I'm like, okay, so clearly they see it. Like, no, we don't run out in that rain.
Yeah.
That's creepy eye rain. We don't need that.
Let's go into the maze and make out instead.
You know. Yeah. We just gotta, I mean, they couldn't have sex with dudes, but we don't know what they could do with each other. I mean,
are you still a virgin if you just scissor your friend?
No.
Oh, physically.
What friends are you scissoring? I'm not talking to you.
I'm just saying no.
You don't have anything to scissor with, Saul. You don't have an opinion.
How did we get to scissoring?
I don't know.
Kim's saying no.
Can two chicks scissor with a... Hey, Kim says no. They can't do it.
Yeah, so they run out and go make out.
Okay, wait. So why? Okay, it gets to that where like they have that weird scene or whatever. But then we get to a scene where it's like later on in the same afternoon, and then Lucy is dressed up like a slutty piñata, and she's walking around that red thing. And that's when 11-year-old Paul was like, "Holy mother!" Because this is the part, Saul, where Mina's running out with no bra on and she's running down those stairs.
That's the second part,
like,
I was going to
think. Lucy! And I'm like, "Holy Lucy."
The first time we watched this movie together, Paul pointed it out and I was like, "I've literally never noticed that." And he was like, you've never, like, he was flabbergasted that I had never noticed that. I'm like, "I have boobs.
Her boobs just bouncing around while she's like, "Lucy." And I'm like, "Holy mother."
I don't focus on boobs.
I thought it was going to be one of two scenes.
It's not even that you have to focus on them. They almost smack her in the face while she's running after her friend.
I thought it was going to be two scenes. I either thought it was going to be the little orgy or I was going to, this is the other one that I was thinking of, is when she's running out and they're just flopping everywhere.
Saul noticed. Kim, did you not notice? Kim noticed.
No,
said, yeah.
We don't notice boobs, man. We don't look. We don't care.
It's not even, okay, I was 11 again, first of all, and I was like, "Oh, let's rewind that." Wait, who's she looking for? I didn't hear what she said.
Yeah, that's what you're uncomfortable about, not the orgy scene before, if you're watching this with your parents.
Okay. Maybe the orgy scene would have been cool and all watching, but then you're like, that vampire girl's connected. That's gross. This is so now every scene where they show those random body shots, like it's just ruined now. They're just conjoined people. This is weird. Why would you show me this?
That's not your kink. Hey, that's probably somebody's kink.
Hey, there's something out there for everybody. Listen to the Blade. No, it was the, listen to our Dreamcatcher podcast. Something for everybody.
Something for everybody out there.
Lucy! See, it's just...
But that's the same night that Drac gets there, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, he gets there and has Wolfman sex with Lucy in werewolf vampire crypt sex. This is what I wrote down.
I wrote, "Lucy goes for a nighttime stroll and gets fucked by a vampire wolf bat."
Yes. Which was just weird.
For Werewolf, Vampire, Crypt Sex. It's a cool band name.
And like they fuck like three times though. Him and Lucy get it on a couple times.
I know. That's why after she dies, it's like he has that moment where it's like, oh, the vampire force just died a little bit. And so he's like, no, my side piece.
My side piece.
Like, damn it.
No, I thought it was funny that he's like, I'm coming to England to find Mina, who is my Elisabetta. And then he starts banging Lucy because he needs to drain her and just have sex. And, you know, because it's been a while. He's got to work some tolerance up.
He's
got to
get some cobwebs out.
And then it's like he's having sex with her there. And when Mina comes in and finds her and she sees whatever, he has it look like, oh, fuck. Like, this is your friend? Like, what are the fucking odds? God damn, I've already screwed this up and I've hardly been here for 10 fucking minutes or whatever, man.
Then he's like, don't see me.
Don't see me.
And I assume that little flash of light meant that it took her memory of seeing him away. Like,
maybe it was
kind of hypnotized or something.
I don't know. Could have been.
Because it just gets really bright. And then she's like, you were dreaming.
Like, you're just, your boobs and your vagina's out. And you're like,
what the fuck is going on with you, Lizzie? Like,
what? Maybe she's a sleepwalker. You don't know.
Sleep fucker.
She's a sleep fucker.
Lucy!
At least do it with me again.
Yes, I...
Go into the crypt to have sex.
But then we see that Mina and Drac just meet in the daytime on the streets of London.
Yes.
I love how at first she's like, fuck off, fucking foreigner.
I know. She gets real annoyed. She's like, should I call the police, little fucker? You
shall
fucking
I call
weirdo?
My husband.
No, and I, more power to her. People are creepy.
I loved his top hat.
His top hat and his cane.
I do have to say, especially in the scenes later when they're doing the raid on Carfax Abbey and all that, there's a lot of diversification and types of hats in this movie.
There is, yes.
Especially with all three of the guys, and then you got Van Helsing in there. He's got like an Indiana Jones hat. Like,
he does.
Like the English guys have like the top hats, and then you've got the Quincy P. Adams has got his cowboy hat. So it's like a lot of different hats.
Did you notice that when the three gentlemen callers come in the beginning, the maid or the butler try to take Quincy's hat?
Yeah, he's like, no.
This is my hat.
But then it gets settled. Okay, that's one of the scenes where there's a lot of movie mistakes. Because it's like, you
I
go
was
in.
I looking for that and I couldn't find it.
No, you go trivia. In and you watch it and you see that it's after the scene where she's like, let me touch your knife or whatever.
Okay.
And then he's standing there and then Jack Seward comes in and he falls over. He trips over the polar bear
the
head.
Polar bear head, yes.
Polar bear tripped me, is what I wrote down. After that happens, he comes in and sits down. So when he comes in and sits down, the Quincy Adams is standing there. Quincy Morris. I don't know why I keep saying Adams.
Quincy Adams?
Quincy Morris. He's standing there with he's holding his hat. And then it cuts to like a close up. And then it pulls back out, and then when he stands up, he pulls up the hat like he's like accidentally sat on it. So like, the hat is reappearing and disappearing because then it's not in the guy's hand, and it was like, oh, he sat on it. And like, I'm like, all right.
I thought it was gonna be something more obvious because I kept paying attention to every time I saw what's his face, Gary Oldman with his top hat. I thought that's what it was gonna be. And then there's a couple other scenes too. I'm like, where is this?
There's a few movie mistakes here, but they're just so like you're so enamored with the beauty of this. Epic movie. Oh, but no, in the dinner party scene, I forgot to mention that's when we have Drax shadow over the whole scene, and it stops on Lucy's boobs, or not Lucy, it stops on Mina's boobs, because this is all about Drac is a boob man, because watch when we get to the parts,
it is Drac who is the boob man.
Okay, maybe it's FFC. Okay, maybe it's FFC,
or
but
maybe
this,
it's Paul.
This whole movie. wait till Mina. Wait till we talk about Mina on the way to the Carpathian Mountains and all that shit. On the way to Drac's castle. I will point it out and you'll watch this movie and be like, he's right.
Hey, it's not my fault you were just glued to boobs in every scene of this film.
It's not about 11-year-old Paul.
It's not even the boobs. Like, we'll get to it. All right.
Just think about this. Paul was 11 when he saw this, so he's just channeling his inner 11-year-old all over again.
Boobs have just been ingrained in Paul's brain. It's a core memory for him.
Yeah, there's a... Yes, I can never see Winona Ryder without yelling, Lucy! Seeing boobs flopping around. I thought it was funny that when they're... Okay, we're back on the street, right? And she's like, you fucking foreigner. I'm like, should I call the police? And then she's like, maybe you're acquainted with my husband. And I thought it's funny that Drac's like, oh, you have a husband? I won't bother you anymore. You know, he's just being respectful or whatever. And she's like, well... never mind, I'm horny. And then she's like, let's go to the movies together.
I know,
like,
they go to the movies.
And like, you just flip-flopped like nothing. Like, that was quick. Like, not even, like, he didn't even do anything. Like, unless he tranced or whatever and you don't see that.
It's like, as soon as he lost all interest in her, she was like, no, I want him now.
Yeah, it was very...
It's very, fine, I don't like you. Why?
Yeah, it's, and that's a trope. Women aren't like that. I'm like, thank you, leave me alone.
Some away. Are. Some are. And if they are, that's not the ones you want to be around.
No.
If anyone's like, they're men and women. I'm sure they're like that. So.
Every woman I've ever known that's told a man to leave her alone, she really wants that man to leave her alone. Just say it.
That's not what movies have taught me. Yeah.
But then he like confesses all of his undying love to her. It's like, I've crossed oceans of time for you.
That line is why he wanted to do the movie. He's like, that is a cool fucking line.
It is a cool fucking line.
I want to be in this movie. When he read that in the script, Gary Oldman, not, you know, Vlad himself or whatever. But she's like, I am Prince Vlad. And she's like, oh, you're fucking prince. Let's go to the movies. Then.
I'm not married yet. He's rich. I mean,
yeah, I'm going, I am Prince Vlad, blah, blah, blah. We're like, I was like, a prince. And I put with that, like, slowly, like, kind of melodramatic, romantic tone they had with it. I'm like, anyone would fall in love with anyone with that music in the background.
Yeah.
There you go.
I'm like, the lady at the DMV, I'm like, you don't look too bad with this background. Man, how you doing?
I love when shit goes crazy in the movie theater and he's just like, come meet my cool wolf friend.
Yeah, but it's like the wolf speaks Romanian, apparently.
Like, and then they're just in there petting a wolf and I'm just like, what
are y'all doing? When the wolf escapes from the zoo, the first shot that he escapes or whatever, I love that the wolf's just going back and forth because it's clearly like a trained wolf or whatever.
Yeah. Right? Yeah.
And it's like circling back and forth. And then at one point, it's like, fuck it. It just walks through the bars, which are clearly, you know,
they're big enough for it to get out,
you know, for the shot or whatever. But I always thought it was funny. He was just like, fuck it. And he just locks out like nothing. I'm like, you just do that anytime, though.
Yeah.
But then we cut back to Lucy, who clearly needs Dr. Van Helsing now. And so Dr. Stewart's like, I know the crazy person who needs to help us in this crazy situation.
That, yeah, that's when the trio gets back to the house.
Yeah.
And I always thought it was funny that Artie Holmwood, played by Cary Elwes. I always thought he's like, oh, you're just a sore loser because she picked me to get married. And he's like, ah, whoa, she needs mental. Okay, let's see. He's like, holy shit. He's like, call the guy. Yeah, call the guy right now. He's like, good God, man. Yeah, he was like, good God, man. Spare no expense. Bring him post haste.
Well, Van Helsing, when we meet him in that little doctor observation teaching room
where
thing.
He discusses diseases of the Venus, which means vagina diseases.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's talking about syphilis. He's talking about syphilis and blood diseases, but he lets that bat bite him and then he puts his finger in his mouth. And I'm like, no, stop.
Like, you have rabies.
Yes.
Which would make a lot of sense with the way he acts later in the movie.
It really
was. He is pretty fucking like out there as a character himself. Because I wrote down, like, this is when Van Helsing is very inappropriate the first time.
Yep. And then we focus back in on Jonathan for a little bit.
I think
we need
to bring that, like, that knocking thing back, like, at the end of a good speech or something. It's like, all right.
Oh, yeah.
Like, all the academics were just knocking. And I'm like,
instead of clapping, they're doing the knocking.
That was a very weird, like auditorium. Like, it was very, like, menacing looking. And I know that's what they look like, but it's always, like... It's so like, it's almost like it's academic and creepy at the same time where it's like, we're going to cut up a bunch of bodies in the name of science.
I mean, they literally used to do like lobotomies in that, rooms like that.
Yeah. That,
so they used to use the most cruel types of medicine
these cadavers that we just got shipped to us from H.H. Holmes in America.
Yes. That's a true story, by the way.
It is.
Yeah.
Look it up.
But back to this movie that's still going on.
Jonathan is a barely alive sex slave at this point. Yes. We get little glimpses of him just touching base with us.
I mean, are they even fucking him at this point or are they just eating him?
Okay. I don't know. It's like maybe both. They're, you know, literally he's a fun toy and he feeds us.
Mm. Yeah.
Because they need you know, sustenance still, I guess.
So he's still in his...
still barely alive sex slave.
So is he just in a polyamorous relationship at this point?
He's with the four or five of...
The four or five
the
way?
Four and a half?
Yeah.
I know this is jumping a little ahead, but I love how when he gets back to the place, and who was it? Was it Van Helsing or was it one of the other guys when they said, well, while you were having your...
Oh, yeah, that's Van Helsing. He's like kind of like... You need to answer me.
Yeah. Okay, so it was Van Helsing. Yeah. He tells him, he's like, so while you were having your infidelity.
Yeah, yeah, he clearly lays it out.
Well, no, but then he gives him that like built-in excuse. He's like, because Jonathan has this line where he's like, you know, when I was under their trance, where it was like, oh, yes, clearly you were not, you know, responsible for anything that you
so
did.
So while you
like,
were fucking them is basically how he like, said it in, you know, like, proper English. Yeah.
While you were with your infidelity of the vampire brides.
While you were having your four or five way, we haven't discovered which yet. Yes. No, he, I love it, crazy Van Helsing, because he's just asking everybody hard questions. Yeah. Like, and he gives no fucks about it. He's like, okay, come with me. We're going to cut off her head and stare her through the heart. All right, let's go. Like he's like, and like they always leave it to where these people are like, what?
That's the inappropriate number two, I think. Okay. All right, where are we at then?
Mina and Drac are just going on dates.
Yeah.
Like she ain't even worried about Jonathan, who's in fucking Transylvania anymore. She's just out there going on dates. They're out there drinking absinthe together. And if Dracula can turn tears into diamonds. Like,
seriously. Okay, that alone, I think you could have any woman you want.
Yeah. Like.
Hello.
Here's your tears into diamonds. There you go.
Like what?
I need that skill. I want that skill.
Bury me. I wrote down the green fairy led Mina to the land beyond the forest because that is the what she says when she's like imagining Transylvania, and that's the literal translation of Transylvania is the land beyond the forest.
Mm. Mm. I was like, yeah, Mina's over here just remembering past lives. Yeah. She's just uncovering.
Well, she's drinking
memories.
Absinthe that what? Doesn't supposedly doesn't it make you see a green fairy?
Yeah, that's why
yeah,
I said
it's the
green
word.
Fairy,
it makes you hallucinate.
The green
yeah.
fairy led you to the land beyond the forest.
Mm-hmm.
In a green haze.
Meanwhile, Jonathan's sneaking out of the castle.
Jonathan like, finally finds a way out with this.
He's out of cum. He's out of blood. He's like, I gotta get out of here.
And he crawls over to the some convent where it's like the smallest little shack building.
No,
like,
first he like, slides down the yeah, side of the castle.
He slides like, down the side into like the probably like the river or whatever, and just washes up somewhere mm-hmm. while it's raining. And he. He's like, I couldn't even have sex with you if I wanted to, but could you please give me a place to sleep tonight?
I'm so hungry. I'm so please, hungry. God. Help me.
No more sex. I love the letter like, dearest Mina, Jonathan is actually alive still.
Oh, yes. The nuns are so nice. Yes. Yep.
He insists you are in danger and must come marry him at once.
When Van Helsing first meets Mina, he smells her.
He does. Okay, this is what I wrote down.
Sign number two.
This was the first time that he was inappropriate with Mina, or just inappropriate in general.
In general,
because because she goes up and he's like, ah, I mean, he starts dancing with her and like smelling her and like he has. I think he's a weird, creepy line he says to her. Something.
He
too, like.
Has weird. He's just a weird character. Yeah. Just always yeah.
Yeah, I just put a yeah.
Yeah.
Van Helsing is creepy with Mina. I wrote down. This is where Lucy has her freak out. Like, fucking garlic!
Mm-hmm.
The garlic everywhere!
And then all of a sudden he's like, I remember the ancient book I need for this.
No, it was because at first Quincy comes in and he basically is like, look, if you don't get better, I'm going to shoot you in the backyard.
Yeah.
Because he has that joke and he's like,
I'll put you down.
Like, they told me I got to put you down if you don't get better, Miss Lucy. Like, I'm like, okay, I know you're not joking though, because like that was just done back then. Like,
yeah.
Because he's like, I got to put you down like a lame horse there, mm-hmm. Miss Lucy. And it's like, he's not joking, everyone.
No.
You've seen the knife and he also probably has a gun. He is American. He's packing heat. He's going to take you down. Because then later he has the fucking the gun, like the rifle. He's just like at fucking ease on the horseback, chasing the carriage.
Things,
like just he's got the
he's killing gypsies one by one.
He's got the reins in his hand and the shotgun or the rifle in his hand, just mm-hmm. going down. He's like
hat's still fucking on top of his head.
He just does that pro. quick pickup. He's like Harker, just hop on. He just grabs him real quick. He's like, I'm in my element, man. He's like, so yeah, again, yeah, he would have no problem taking her out back and mm-hmm. just, you know, handling that shit. And he's like, you don't get better, I'm going to have to take you out back, Lucy.
I got no choice.
And then that's when Lucy tries to bite him real quick. And then basically Van Helsing like smacks her in the forehead and lays her down. He's like, oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Nosferatu. I see the teeth.
I need to get in my vampire book.
Yeah. Yeah. And then he has that. We cut to that scene where I wrote, Dracula gets a bad note.
Yeah. Nope. It's a bad note.
It was a bad note.
I wrote, Drac rage eats Lucy while Jonathan and Mina get hitched.
And before that, Mina does the 1897 equivalent of deleting Facebook posts while she's ripping pages out of her diary. And like, bitch, why are you littering the ocean? Like, this is why we have so much shit today, because all of you fuckers back then usually just shit in the ocean all the fucking time. Like, shit in a bucket, throw in the ocean.
Let the waves wash away. No, fucker, don't let it wash away. That goes into the ocean.
I did find that scene funny when she was ripping pages out of it. She's like, oh shit, I gotta get married and I gotta get rid of evidence of what I did.
She's like, delete.
Jonathan was getting his, even if it was under vampire hypnosis or whatever.
Wait till the end here, because and he has this whole like, wind.
He does.
The crying scene where he's like that old
the
face.
The Cowardly Lion
like,
one?
Yes, that one. That's what you're talking about. Yeah. I'm like, that is exactly it. I'm like, he's just cried himself into like, was he just like albino and fucking just like his face was melting from the crying kind of thing. Like, why don't you turn those into diamonds, motherfucker? Right? Like,
and if I'm a vampire, I don't want to still have feelings. This is stupid.
I know. Like, that's the other thing. Like, you don't like, everyone is always thinking like, oh, living forever would be like, what if like turning into a vampire? Like, what if it had like just severe pitfalls? Like, not even like emotional pitfalls or anything
like
that.
Like, you still have all the human, like, am I gonna still have depression? Yeah, like,
still have diabetes. You still gonna be like, but I don't have to eat anymore. How does that even fucking work? Like,
I'm a vampire with restless leg syndrome. Doesn't seem right.
Like, no, like, what if you were a vampire? Like, okay, you get to live forever. Like, you can still go out in sunlight, but your powers don't work as much. You know, that's the rules they set for this one. Whatever.
Yeah.
But what if it's like, you're always gonna feel like you have to take a shit though, like just for the rest of your life. Like,
but you're not gonna
But you don't have to shit, and you can't actually shit anymore because you don't eat anymore. You don't need to, but everything's dead. But you're just
gonna feel
like you have to take a shit, and that there's nothing you'd be like. Why didn't you tell me this before you fucking turned me? Well, no one told me.
Yeah, that's rough. That's a rough life, man.
Or you have to pee, but you don't actually get to pee. Like
how are you just gonna be sad for eternity? That just
Imagine the blue balls Drac had during the 4 centuries of all this. Because the scene after the crypt sex scene, the werewolf crypt sex.
Yeah,
when he stops or whatever, and you know, and he's just fucking, you know, going at it with her, and then Mina shows up, and then it cuts to them like that tracking shot where like they're leaving. She's like, oh, Mina, let's get back. And then he's just there in the foreground like, oh,
I was like he's
nursing. Like, that sounds like a terrible case of blue balls that he's like, god damn it, I was almost there. Like,
you could
4 centuries and like you have to walk in.
You need to just finish.
Well, he was waiting for them to leave. He's a gentleman, for Christ's sake. He's like, he's not fucking Louis C.K. He's like, have some respect, Dracula.
That's fair. He was a gentleman.
No, he was.
He was a prince,
This is your friend. Excuse me. You're going to have to go finish in the crypt.
I love how Van Helsing has no bones about, like, he's just like, that bitch going to rise out of that grave later. Like, we have to get going.
This is where he has, like, another random scene where he's just being inappropriate. Because it's the carriage pulls up, and that's when he's like, I figured it out. He's like, she's a bitch of the devil, a whore of darkness.
Yes.
He's just going on, and he does that thing where
I must dine.
When he's like, where he kind of, like, hugs and humps Quincy. He's like, a bitch of the devil. And he's like, but first, I must eat. Feed me.
I know. And then that's when he rage eats Lucy and she dies. But when they go to her grave later, I love when they pop the grave and there's no Lucy.
Okay, wait. Artie drops the fucking ball on this one. It's Artie's fault.
Artie, which one's Artie?
Arthur Homewood, Cary Elwes.
Oh, okay.
Was sitting there, he's like, I'm just going to play with this pistol and get drunk until I pass out. And then when he passes out, that's when Drac comes in and just fucking just
eats Lucy.
Eats yeah. Lucy and just fucking goes to town. Like the dripping blood scene when everyone comes into the room and it's like the shadow, but you still have that dripping blood as it's going out. I'm like, that was fucking cool.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But when I like when they pop her grave and nobody's like, that's when they're like, oh shit. That's when they start to believe.
Yeah. Artie has his own, what did you do with her?
Yeah. Like, and then they're like, just wait.
Like she'll be back.
She'll be back. Mm-hmm. And if she doesn't come, then you can shoot me. Like,
yeah. During the funeral or the wake or whatever in the house. I love that. That's when Van Helsing has that scene with Dr. Seward. He's like, we need a set of post-mortem knives. He's like, are we doing an autopsy? He's like, no, I just want to cut her head off later.
I want to cut her head off.
Like, we'll talk later. You go mourn.
Yeah. Like, don't worry. I got to do this later.
I wanted to marry this girl. God damn it, doctor.
He's like, and you want to cut her fucking head off? What's wrong with you?
And then she comes into the crypt with a baby crying away.
That kid was scared shitless of that little girl was frightened of Sadie Frost, who played Lucy. The makeup and the hair and the costume, everything, she was frightened to death of Sadie Frost. So she had to, FFC and Sadie Frost had to like talk the girl into doing more than one take because she was just absolutely. Like,
and
you see it in her
parents.
The little girl. Like, just frightened as shit of like everything. Like, once it was like full makeup and all that, like, yeah. She was scared shitless of everything. Because she has blood on her fucking teeth the whole time,
yeah,
too.
She does.
So it's like, she was scared shitless. So they had to talk her into doing more than one take or whatever. But it always reminds me of Dracula Dead and Loving It, too. Like, just that scene where it's just that so much blood. He's like, I think she's dead enough or whatever.
Yeah. I love when she just straight pukes blood on Van Helsing. She's just like, fuck her.
They filmed that and ran it in backwards to make it look more creepy.
Yeah.
She's getting back into the tomb or whatever. So, the rigidity of like the movements, I think, really lends to a lot of the scenes, especially when you have that like that Dracula Evil Dead cam where it's just like going in and all that. So definitely just a lot of camera work that they play with. And it's like it doesn't like let up in some scenes because it's like it's not always scenes that, you know, would probably make sense, you know, just. The fact that it's just the vampire movements, I think they want to just fuck with things more. And I think he did a really good job of, like, you know, just keeping that in mind throughout the movie.
Yeah. But then they cut off Lucy's head and stake her through the heart.
I love how this was finally their awakening to be like, oh, shit, something's really fucking going on. And it took that for them to be.
I love when they round up their posse to go kill Dracula.
Yeah, that's when we cut to, like, they cut her head off. And that has that cut where Drek's like, no, my side piece is dead or whatever. And then we cut straight to that big just hunk of beef where he's having the dinner with Lucy and Jonathan after that.
Yeah.
He's like, you cut her head off. And he's like well, we ran a stake through her heart and we cut her fucking head off. And he's like, doctor. And he's like, can we eat now? I'm starving.
I'm hungry. Come on.
That was my friend.
I'm like, that's a weird transition into the beef. And I'm like, I'm going to cut that and just to be like,
yeah.
Where it's, you know, they cut her head off and run the stake through her heart, and then it cuts to that beef, and then it's just, that's the end of the commercial. Beef. It's what's for dinner. Really.
Yeah. But then they round up a posse to go kill Drac, and I wrote, Van Helsing's cackle is my favorite. Because he's just, like, cackling away. He's just laughing at things. Like, I think she's okay. Like, just laughing. And then Renfield is just fucking rambling at this point. You can hear him screaming out the windows. To his master.
You betrayed me.
Mm-hmm. And they take Mina to the asylum to keep safe.
Keep her safe.
How is that safer than, like, you know, not anywhere near, you know, the asylum or Carfax Abbey where Dracula lives?
It looked like it was just across the street.
It literally is, because you have, like, right. As they're going in, he's like, master, they're coming! Like, okay, really? You couldn't shut this guy up? No. Element of surprise is gone.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's literally like right next to it, because even in the Dracula Dead and Loving It how he's like, oh yeah, I'm right next door to you in the insane asylum. I'm Dr. Seward. I run the thing. So like they're fucking neighbors.
They are.
Like,
yeah.
You couldn't have shut this guy up or, you know, not done anything. Isn't there a mouth equivalent of the long sleeve thing you can put on him or something?
I would think so. But I love when Renfield's like, listen,
give him
bitch,
some morphine.
You need to get out of here. Like you need to go and just get out of here. Don't stay here. And she's like, I'll be fine.
No, I wrote,
it's okay.
My master tell me when he is coming.
Yes.
Like, it's horrible.
Like Renfield. Oh.
Like he actually just makes him listen to him come.
Ew.
That's what Renfield meant. He's like, master is coming. Make it stop.
Make it stop.
Please.
Oh, oh puppy. Terrible. Oh, puppy.
That's terrible.
When Dracula comes to Mina and he's just like, there's no life in here.
In Jack Seward's creepy bachelor pad, a sane asylum.
A bed. Yeah, he has got a bed
his
in there,
studio,
but he calls
asylum.
It his office.
Yeah.
Like, he's like, stay in my office and you'll be fine.
Yeah,
he
says stay in my office at one point, but at first he's like, I'll take her to my private quarters, you know, this and that. So I'm like, he does live there, but I don't know. It's just weird. I'm like, either way, like, in the nut house is not where I would feel safest.
Yeah, that doesn't...
Exactly.
Even though there's a fucking vampire outside, I don't know. Maybe it's just me. And it's like, you didn't even have anyone watch her, because then Drac just shows up and he's like, what's up? We're going to do this or what?
I mean, they have a little fight about Lucy. She's like, you killed Lucy, you fucker.
And she gets over that real fucking quick.
Oh, no. Yeah. Mina's full on board. She's like, I need some dick. And I've had some dick. I want some of your dick now. She's fully let's swap some bodily fluids and I'll be with you forever.
Yeah. But she's like, you killed me. Like, what are you? Like, what? Wait. There was a line where she wrote down. Oh, yeah. She wrote down, like, what are you? And then he turns and he's like, he gives that look. And I wrote down, like, I have a tragic backstory. And then he just goes into this whole thing or whatever. And she's like, yeah. And then she just gets over that. I wrote, Mina gets over the fact that he's a vampire and murdered Lucy pretty fucking quickly. And he's like, drink and join me in eternal life. And then she's like, keeps going, and they wrote down, and he's probably like, ow. Because she keeps going. He's like, no, I can't do it. I can't. Like, motherfucker, you've killed how many people just to get here? Now you're going to bitch out? Like, yes. I love you too much to do it. This is the one scene in this movie that I'm like, all right, this is too much. I get that it's this whole eternal struggle where he's like, I love you, but I can't condemn you to this life because you're always going to feel like you have to take a shit and you can't shit because that's what being a vampire is. And I get that it's this whole struggle and all that, but it's just like, okay, she's willing now. So I don't know. It's just, it was too much for me. This is the one scene in the whole fucking movie that's too much for me. So please, I will give you permission, Saul. You can shit on this scene all you want. Because this is the one scene. This is the one scene where I'm like,
one scene.
It's just too much for me. It's too over the top with the dramatics on this.
And I love the next scene that follows, and when you just follow Drac's red eyes into the shadows and he turns into all those rats.
That, that is always a cool scene, which...
they recreated in What We Do in the Shadows.
Yes, the first season, I believe, in the parking.
Yes.
Gregor.
Jeff. Jeff.
Yes.
I always thought, like, so if I killed some of those rats, would Drac come back with, like, you know,
missing a hand
or something?
Yeah.
Or would the rat just regenerate and then run out to catch the others? Like, I don't know. I was like, I would just fuck with things like that. Because, like, what if you have to lose at that point? Like, he turned into rats. Like,
yeah.
I mean, I know they were all afraid of rats because they're, you know, pale English dudes or whatever, but...
And it only been a few hundred years since the bubonic plague.
Van Helsing's letting bats bite him and shit and drinking blood, so he doesn't give a fuck. He's like, I got rabies. I'm like, he was inappropriate. It was the fucking rabies or syphilis. Maybe he had syphilis and he was going crazy.
But then back to Romania. We've got to beat Drac with our modern technology of travel.
Wait, I wrote down... That scene where he comes in as the green fog, which looked really cool.
Oh, right? Yeah.
I wrote down, Mina gets foggy.
I wrote, Mina starts to get really horny as she starts to turn. Because it's like a show her like.
Okay. Hold on. Write down. Let me see.
I think it's back to boob talk.
Mina keeps acting like her boobs are on fire. every time that she gets that like Drac thing, it's always like she pulls her boobs out or she's like, oh, like my boobs are on fire. That's what he's doing. She's dying. So yeah, that's the other downside, women. If you're going to just start turning into a vampire, it's going to feel like your boobs are on
fire. Your tits are on fire.
As your body is dying, your boobs are on fire. Maybe not the full time that you're a vampire, but at least as you're turning, your boobs are on fire. And then when you fully turn, you feel like you got to take a shit.
Oh, the worst internal life ever. So
what do werewolves feel like?
Oh. Yeah. But then they get to, there's a lot of mumble jumble about why they beat them to the castle. Their whole like travel strategy is shown throughout the whole film.
To me, it was the worst chase scene ever.
It was because Drac kept getting ahead of them. Yeah. And it was like, they've outsmarted us again.
Okay. All right. I have to say this, and I get that in the movie it seems really stupid. In the book, there goes into a lot more detail to where Drac is actually using his powers to like make winds faster and like make other things like slow them down. Like he is using his powers like throughout the thing and like using her as like kind of a beacon to know where they are at all times. And that's
kind of the thing that I thought with them like, too was pretty stupid. If you're gonna take her with you.
Yeah, I kept thinking too, I'm like, maybe the plan where you're going to split up, don't say it in front of her. You know, maybe where you're looking at maps and coming up with plans, you know, maybe she's in the other room or, you know, just make sure just that she's not listening.
Go to
a different
train car to have your travel strategies.
You know, like, my question too is like, why even fucking take her? You know he wants her. Why are you even bringing her?
Well, her love had to set the spirit free or some stuff at the end.
Her line. we'll get to that. When I forgot to mention when Drac is turning her, it's so like compassionate and just so like dramatic that I put Drac finally turns Mina to completion, because he has that scene where he's like, oh, like after she drinks of him and all that. I'm like,
it's
finally,
it's very sexual.
My blue balls. Mm-hmm. Oh, God.
But for some reason, Mina and Van Helsing.
That's why he's so pissed later.
Vina
and Van Helsing.
Mina and Van Helsing go to the castle. And Van Helsing calls the brides the Whores of Satan. And I wrote, that's a cool band name, I call it. The Whores of Satan. It's a cool band name.
Well, not if it's really...
But then the fuckers eat the horses.
Yeah.
And I love how Van Helsing gets so pissed. He's like, fuck you. The next morning, he cuts their heads off. They're asleep.
I got mad because like those poor horses didn't do anything. They were just there to take the people.
That's why Van Helsing gets his revenge.
Yeah, that's when he comes to like, bitches, you're gonna cut up my horses? And he cuts off their fucking heads and then goes out to like the ledge or whatever and calls out Dracula. He's like, fucking come get me, bitch.
No, he just tosses
like,
them.
I love
over
he's
the
like
end.
Tossing heads around. I'm like, that is some fucking like that's the Van Helsing we need this whole time.
Yes.
Again, it's either the syphilis or his rabies that is making him just go batshit crazy.
But at this point we just need it.
Okay, but then it doesn't happen enough because then later when they're almost to the castle and Mina's up on the thing just shouting Romanian and like bringing up the blue flames and all that. I'm like, motherfucker, look alive and get up and stop her ass.
Yeah.
Like just throw a rock at her head. Like do something. Because like it is not working. Okay. And then we skip the part where fucking Van Helsing is just kind of going with Mina. For a second.
Yeah,
where she's like, I know you want my fire boobs.
Well, that's when her boobs get really hot again. And she's like, ah, boobs.
She's like, only you can quench my fire.
Come fuck me.
And he goes with it for a minute. And I want to believe that he's just like, all right, I'm going to just trick you. But I'm like, no, he was gone.
No, he was like, oh, my dick is hard. Is she into this? Because I could be into this.
Well, Jonathan's not here.
I wrote, Mina casts some blue circles into the sky. But what did that even do?
I don't know what it does, but either way, if you're fighting forces of evil, stop someone from shouting shit in Romanian on a ledge that's gonna make blue flames come up.
Yep.
Yeah,
because what's it gonna hurt to stop that? At any point in life,
I don't know. But then Quincy gets it in the back with a sword.
I was sad at him.
I wrote, Quincy!
I'm like, that's a cool way to go out, but then no one will ever know or believe you.
Yeah.
That it's like, oh, my uncle died in Romania. I don't know what the fuck happened. He was doing something. Like, no one's going to believe, he died
fighting a vampire.
Like, cool way to go out if anyone believed you or could prove that, but...
He went out on his feet.
Yeah, it was real quick that they got okay, what was the point of the gate closing if Mina just walks around it later somehow and finds a way in? I'm like,
not just that though, but if you looked at the gate, I'm like, sure little ass can fit right
through. She probably could have fit through it. She was skinny. Except if it wasn't for the probably like the butt cage
thing. The butt dress, yeah.
That's probably what kept her from it.
But they all come out with swords and they're just chopping at, they're just trying to basically exsanguinate fucking Dracula. They want all of his blood out. They're just cutting like his throat.
Like he jumps out of the box and then it's a quick, is it Quincy? I think it's Quincy.
Quincy gets a cut.
Quincy gets that quick because he jumps up to the box and starts to open it. And that's when he gets the knife in the back. And then Drac jumps up and Quincy gives him a quick slash across the throat.
Yeah.
And then Drac throws him. And I think Homewood comes in and that's when he's like knife to the chest or whatever.
Yeah. They all get a couple good licks in. But then Drac crawls back into his castle.
Okay, fuck Jonathan, first of all, because there was the whole scene where Mina gets the rifle or whatever, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Mina gets the rifle, and then she's like, no, no, will you do the same to me when I turn? And then Jonathan has that line where he's like, our work is finished, and hers is just starting. And I'm like, Homewood's like, fuck you, motherfucker. I want vengeance for Lucy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Calling me back. I'm going in there and finishing this shit. Like, what the fuck do you mean her work is just starting? Like, you're just going to let them go? Like, what the fuck does that mean? Like, no, you go in there. You finish that
what
shit.
What if he eats her and then, like, we...
And then we just leave
all
them?
That blood back.
Yeah, like, and we just leave them out. To regenerate and just be, you know... existing in the world.
I mean, there should have been a supervisor in the room at least.
Like, we need to make sure this shit gets finished. Like, Quincy didn't die for nothing, goddammit.
Yeah.
But then he's all dead and he says, give me peace. Mina cuts off his head.
She had the bloody kiss.
She did kiss. Yeah. And
then she's like, then I realized how my love can release us all from darkness. I'm like, bitch, you really fooled yourself, ain't you? Like,
yeah.
You didn't do nothing special. Like, you just looked like some other chick from the past. Yeah. Like, you didn't do anything extraordinary. This motherfucker made diamonds out of tears. He did, yeah. Right? Like, Quincy fucking... We were talking about his badass on the fucking horse and everything. Like, he... Like, everyone did something but you.
Yep.
You were the least.
It was my love. Like, no, you didn't. Like,
you were basically the road. Yeah, carried around here.
Yeah, I'm like, Jonathan and Mina get back together and after this, and like forever their relationship was like, you left me for Dracula. Well, you had sex with 3.5 fucking vampire bitches. So we're even. Like,
oh, they're going to have to just let that shit go. They need to move on. I mean, they're going to stay married. They're just both going to have to let it go.
How do you live a normal life? Also, does fucking... communion wafers can kill vampires because that was what it was.
I thought it was like a little coin or something.
It looked like a communion wafer, but it had designs in it though.
I told Kim, he was like, he's defeating him with a rich cracker.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
if a communion cracker would have like fallen apart on her head, like I don't, those things are so
burned
thin.
Her, though.
It yeah. did, but it was it like hard thicker. Enough. Yeah, it was thick enough for him to like press against her head.
It looked like a thick communion wafer.
Do they have thick communion wafers?
I don't know. Well, I don't know how they used to make them back then in fucking 1800s.
It just gave me an idea. If I ever get to fight with vampires.
Well, I'm saying we need to try this out. I'm like, okay, pencil in my wrist.
I thought it was like some religious communion, coin or
communion
something.
Wafers in my hand. Just, you know, just.
And then Rich Crackers.
If those work against vampires, then I'm like making super thick.
If I just go buy my own.
Communion wafers, ninja stars.
If I just go buy my own communion wafers, does that like make them.
I don't think you
are
can.
Are they godly?
Gotta get blessed.
I don't think you can buy that. It's not like you can go to the fucking grocery store and like, a pack of communion wafers.
You don't know.
It's like in a Oreo sleeve kind of thing.
You get them from wherever, whoever supplies the churches. So.
Here's what we do. We
got our us. Or
it's not
like
you can
that.
Get a Pringles can if you have
buy
communion
and large
wafers.
Some shit. Here's there's what we some do. Store that's
we go
gotta
to Costco.
Happen.
We bought a big, huge thing of Ritz crackers. We get them blessed by a priest, and we gambit those things and start chucking them at vampires.
If I get a bunch of Ritz crackers and just put a cross on them, will that work against vampires?
I don't know.
That kind of a thing did kind of work in From Dusk Till Dawn.
Well,
they
yeah.
put a bunch of crosses on things and started throwing them.
Yeah, and then at
them.
Some point, like it was just two sticks you
yeah.
know, that you're holding.
Yeah, they turned the gun and the
and
thing.
And then
if we
go off of Fright Night, you have to have faith. So I'm like, these Ritz crackers are going to fucking
faith,
work.
Faith.
I'm telling you, that's what I'm with Paul.
Is it like Pennywise? Like, if I believe this, like, this is battery acid and it works. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah. If I believe the Ritz crackers are going to work,
well, just make Drac believe he's not a vampire, and there you go. Yeah. Just like then they did with Pennywise.
You just convince him it's all a big sham, and he just,
if somebody just would have been like, "Hey, Drac, you're a sloppy bitch." Apparently, that would have just did it for him.
Why? What did I do?
You're a sloppy bitch, Drac. Just got to be said.
See, I love how we're coming up with new innovative ways to beat these vampires.
If I believe pencils, that the pool is enough holy water, so if I bless the whole pool.
So far we got three pencils, now we got Ritz crackers.
Mm-hmm.
This is gonna be.
Can I make a holy net? Think about that.
There we go.
A holy net that I just you throw the net,
it's the
on.
Net of Jesus.
Net of Jesus. That's $39.95 for your holy net.
Yes. Exactly. You have to have
with
that
free,
after.
With free, what's that, the miracle spring water?
Call right now and you will get this spring water.
Jesus net. What do we call the holy net? Hey, the holy we're net. In the wrong business. I'm going to start.
We should have just been evangelicals.
There we go.
Do you need
That was Bram Stoker's Dracula. We seem to have gone off the rails.
What are you saying, yeah, brother? You don't have vampires? Well, damn it, you do.
Yep.
How do you know this safety net don't work? It's doing its job, isn't it? Mm-hmm.
I've never been attacked by a vampire, and I have the holy net. All I'm saying.
It works.
I drink the spring water every day, and I'm not dead yet, so.
Yes.
But that was Bram Stoker's Dracula.
We just need to make a religious version of every product that's already existing. There you go. And then people will buy the stuff. That's it. Who do I call?
I'm telling you, we're going to make some
money. I'm taking investors right now. If you want to get on this train, let's
okay. We'll make some money, go to Costco.
We're not starting a pyramid scheme. Don't come after us, FBI. Anyway, that was Bram Stoker's Dracula. We all pretty much said our final thoughts. This episode's already an hour and 35 minutes.
I think we're all
in
agreement that this is the greatest movie ever, and there's nothing except for that one scene that is wrong with this movie.
Sure, Paul. Anyway, we're coming back next week in December. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody, by the way.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
We let this episode go a little long in case you were lonely this season.
Yes.
And you needed to hear some friends talk. We're your friends. We love you. Happy Thanksgiving.
Yeah, listen to our Blood Rage episode.
Yeah, yes. That's also, and we talk about pie in that one.
Watch the Blood Rage movie with Grandma and then listen to our episode. Yes. And don't talk about politics.
The only thing I remember about the Blood Rage thing is when you're talking about that girl's ass claps.
Ass clapping together, yeah. Ass claps. She runs for it. She... Still, to this day.
You may say I'm a boob man, but apparently Saul's an ass.
That's the only thing I can think of.
Hey, everybody likes what they like.
You see, it's the only thing he thinks of.
Live your life. Live your truth, kids.
Live your truth. The year Frank.
Well, we're coming back next month with 2020 horror. We're going to go back through some 2020 horror movies that came out. We know not a lot came out this year.
Yeah. Tell us what you want us to talk about. We're going to pick 2020 horror movies.
We're picking 2020 horror movies.
We're going to talk about
I think we're going to start next week with Host from Shudder, because that was a big one that came out this year and everybody loved that. So I think that's the one we're going to start off with. So we're going to get into some ghosties.
Yes.
Next week. But we will be back next week for the last fucking month of 2020, y'all.
Hooray.
It is the last month of this godforsaken year, and hopefully better things are on the horizon. So we will see you guys next week. Happy Thanksgiving. We love you.
Bye, everyone.
Eat lots of turkey or tofu or whatever you gotta do.
I like you. I'm not ready to love you yet.
Bye.